Hello, I'm Graham. Hope everyone's having a great day. In today's video, which is the fifth in this series about understanding the Panasonic Lumix FZ150 bridge camera, I want to look at some of the accessories that are available which you might want to purchase to help you expand your photographic opportunities. As you can see, I have a range of accessories which I purchased to help me expand my photography. What I'd like to show you first is my range of close-up lenses. I use the close-up lenses for two reasons. One is obviously to get close into a subject, but the other is also to reduce the maximum working distance of the telephoto lens of this camera. As you know, when the lens is fully extended into its telephoto position, in the autofocus macro mode, the closest focus working distance is 1 meter, and without the autofocus macro mode engaged, it's 2 meters. Sometimes that working distance is just too much, and you can get close enough to fill the frame with your subject, particularly if you're filming things like butterflies or insects. You can get close enough to fill the frame. To enable you to do that, these close-up lenses reduce the working distance of the lens. So they are 52mm close-up lenses, and they're a series of three, and they merely screw onto the front of the lens, which has a 52mm thread. Here are some examples of the shots I've been taking today just to prove the working distance of the lenses, with the number 1, the number 2 and the number 4, and I've also included the working range with the close-up lenses in both wide angle and telephoto position. So they are a valuable piece of kit if you are into close-up photography. The other filters I have here are things like the circular polarizing filter, which is useful in landscapes if you want to take off the sheen off grass or leaves and darken the sky. And obviously the polarizing filter is great if you want to shoot water and you want to like to see through the reflections on the water. So these are available for the camera in 52mm diameter filters. The other filters I have here are neutral density, which I use if I want to reduce the amount of light hitting the sensor. So if I want some long exposures, say I wanted to create a moody scene on a river with very silky smooth water, or a tidal seascape, then to get some exposures in the order of 4 or 5 seconds, you have to reduce the amount of light reaching the sensor. ND4 or ND8 filters are probably required there. Even if you're using ISO 100 and the smallest aperture this camera will give you at F8, in daylight you'll probably not be able to achieve anything like that in terms of exposure. So that's where the ND4 or the ND8 filter will help you achieve that. They can either be the circular filters, which are the easiest to fit, or if you have the Kokin range or the Chinese manufactured lookalikes, then again you can buy the 52mm adapter for the square filter holder, and then that allows you to use these graduated filters. These are neutral graduated, and they're just a piece of acrylic material which have been sprayed with a dye so as to give an indistinct edge. And it's that indistinct edge which allows you to frame up your landscape and cover the sky with the darker material to hold back the sky. As you know, if you do it in landscapes, it's quite easy to burn out skies and clouds because the sensor can't handle the intense dynamic range between the highlights of the cloud and shadows in your landscape. So by using these neutral graduated filters, you can actually offset that exposure in the sky and give yourself a better chance of getting a more balanced exposure. So again, the neutral density graduated filter is another one you might want to consider if you're into landscapes. I also have this color balancing filter. It's an FLD, originally designed to balance daylight negative film, transparency film, to fluorescent lighting. It's a heavy magenta filter. And as you know, the fluorescent lights have a strong green tinge. So this was to filter out that greenness and give a more neutral scene. I use this filter to improve my cityscapes, at night time. So maybe 25 minutes after sundown is the best time to shoot a city sky scene, as that's when the sky takes on that nice glow, but then the fluorescent lights in buildings start to come out and they look greenish and cold in your picture. So to actually warm up the scene using the FLD filter gives you a nice rose colour to the sky and neutralises the fluorescent lights in the buildings, and it's quite a good effect. So that's the FLD filter. Let's talk about wide angle conversion and telephoto adapters for use with the FZ150. Panasonic don't actually recommend you use a wide angle attachment. I've used this with this FZ150 and with my previous FZ100 and FZ38 without any problems, but I haven't used the camera in its zoom mode. I've switched on the camera, allowed the camera to extend to its wide angle position, and then screwed on the adapter and taken the shot. Haven't used the camera in its zoom position. So you can use these if you abide by that rule and don't try to zoom with these attached to your lens. So here is a shot in wide angle, followed by a shot with this 0.45 times wide angle attachment, and it's made by a company called Newer. For the telephoto setting, Panasonic have used a conversion tube. It's called the DMW-LA5, and it's a 62.5mm thread at one end and a 55mm filter thread at the other. And the idea is this screws onto the camera lens barrel, so that when you attach the LT55 telephoto adapter, it doesn't actually put any load onto the lens. This isn't actually the Panasonic telephoto converter, it's one by Konica Minolta, which I had from a previous system. It only had a 49mm filter thread, so I've had to adapt that to 55mm to screw into this lens barrel. So it does become quite a weighty accessory onto your camera, and you really need a fairly sturdy tripod to be able to hold this down. What I think Panasonic should have done was provide a clamp or a collar which would then take the centre of balance to the centre of the combination of the lens and the camera, and that would make it much easier to control your telephoto shots. And that's one of the projects I've got on the drawing board at the moment, is to make a clamp for this telephoto accessory so that the camera is better balanced and more safer. The other thing you might have noticed on the camera is the MS-1 dedicated microphone for the Panasonic range of cameras. This is a self-powered microphone. It has a 1.5-volt battery in the microphone itself. It's a stereo microphone, has wind cut facilities for use outside, but again, it does need a wind muffler if you're outside, because the phone does tend to pick up noise from wind. It's a dedicated microphone, and if you read the advanced guide from Panasonic, it does warn you about using third-party microphones, as it could damage the camera. I've used numerous mics with this FZ150 and with the previous FZ100, from the Rode video mic to some ordinary electric condenser microphones, and I've had no problems whatsoever. The only problem you do have is the adaptation of the microphone's plug. On the MS-1, it's only a 2.5mm plug. Standard microphones come with a 3.5mm, so you have to buy a 2.5 to 3.5 converter to allow you to use external mics with the Panasonic FZ150. But the other thing you might want to purchase is this remote control. Again, Panasonic have their own remote control device, but on eBay you can buy these things for about £10. Just a simple remote control. Again, it's the 4 connector which goes into the remote socket on the side of the camera and allows you to do a single shot, or you can hold the shutter open by pressing and sliding the control button on the remote release. It's 2 function. It provides you the focus facility, and then the second press gives you the exposure. It's great if you're using it on a tripod. saves you having to use a self timer every time, and you can get some good, nice, sturdy shots. And talking of tripods, I've just put this little table tripod on here as just a prompt for the actual use for tripods with the camera. If you're actually going to shoot video, wherever possible, try to use a tripod. There's nothing worse than seeing a lot of videos where the user is subjected to what I call hose reeling. The fact that you've taken your camera and you're all over with the camera, you're zooming in, you're zooming out. The actual user experience is poor. So wherever possible, take your shot from a tripod. Start the scene with an establishing shot, a nice wide angle view, and then if you need to go closer, do your telephoto shot after you've zoomed in and then set the camera. Don't zoom in and zoom back out again. Just a bit of basic film techniques is all that's required there. But back to the subject of tripods. The only disappointment with this camera and the previous camera, the FZ100, is the tripod bush isn't on the optical axis of the camera. It's slightly off to one side. So if you are trying to shoot some panoramic pictures for the panoramic stitch, you find that you can't get a perfect match because the optical node of the lens is changing as you start to do your pan. So if you can see now, the optical node is moving in a semicircular arc with the camera. To overcome that, I designed a plate which fits to the bottom of the camera and repositions the optical center. So I'll fit that and I'll show you the difference. So here is my idea to improve the panoramic performance of the camera. It's just a plate which attaches using a 1/4-20 screw, and it has a plate that's fastened to the one that's fastened to the camera, which puts the mount point for the tripod underneath the center node of the camera. So if I now install this onto the tripod, you'll notice when I pan with the camera doesn't make an arc anymore, it actually pivots on the node of the lens, so that the resulting pictures will actually stitch together to give you a good panorama. So there's a few accessories to expand your photography horizon. I was going to show the flash setup, but I'm going to leave that to in a later video, as one subscriber has asked how to get better flash results using the FZ150. So I think I'll wrap that into another video where we'll consider looking at using the internal flash and using external flash guns with this camera to try and get some better pictures. So okay, that's it for this video. Thanks very much for watching. Thanks for your patience as usual. In the next video, we're going to start to look at using this camera for video, both in the IA mode and in the creative modes. I'll also be looking at some of the accessories you might want to consider if you are going to shoot video. So that's it. Thanks very much for watching. And it's Graham saying, catch you in the next video. Bye for now.